Okay, it's August 1998. It's been about 4 years since we made the original Doing It Right tape. We've made a few workshop tapes, but it's time to make another one. We've made a few changes. We've discovered a few things, mostly to do with decompression and gas mixing. But we've also discovered that in the first tape, we left out a lot of minute details that explain how things are done. So this tape's going to be made with an eye as to why we do what we do, rather than so much the fact that we do it. So first of all, we'll start with the only piece of equipment that we've had to add since the last tape, and this is for the guys that don't do it right. It's a body bag. If you're gonna dive, you're gonna break rule number one and dive with strokes, you need to carry the body bag. If you're going to dive on boats that dive with strokes, you're going to need to carry the body bag. If you're going to breathe the wrong gas or dive deep on air, you need to carry the body bag. Other than that, it's the only new piece of equipment we've had to add. Okay, the other thing that I'd like to introduce to you is the fleet. This is the scooter fleet. Starting over here, we have the NICAD scooter, the famous 90-minute burn time. This is an experimental scooter that burns about 90 minutes. This is the standard workhorse, burns 100 minutes. And these four right here are what we call the four horsemen of Stone's apocalypse. These are the 18,000-foot set. The 115 minutes, 140 minutes, 170 minutes. These are what it took to do the 18,000-foot dive in Wakulla, four each plus those two backups on the floor. So we did the dive with 14 scooters. Anyway, what we're going to do is just go through the whole thing from beginning to end. We're going to mix the gas and just act like we're going to go right into a dive. This is a set of 121s. I usually use 104s, but I just happen to have a set of 121s. These are the pressed steel variety. The manifold is your basic 300 bar center post isolator manifold with flex knobs and burst plugs back here. These burst discs need to be removed and plugs need to be put in them. The tank O-ring will extrude if there's a fire or if the thing's overpressurized. Anyway, these are Joe McGrath bands, good steady, good heavy bands. There's nothing sticking out the back of the tanks. Everything has to be smooth. For cave diving or cold water diving, we're using an argon bottle. We'll get to that in a second. Well, let's just go through what we would do to mix the gas. First of all, we want to put two pieces of tape on the empty tanks. One of these pieces of tape is going to be to record what we put into the tank as we put it in, and the other piece of tape is going to be for the final analysis. Helium, either the helium or the oxygen can be put in first. If you put the oxygen in first and you have high helium banks, you can get your helium pressure a little higher. I tend to like to put the helium in first, let it cool back down, and put the oxygen in. But the trick to this, to getting this right, is to not disconnect the tanks until you've recorded what you've put in. So we add the helium, starting with our lowest banks. We get the helium pressure. In this case, it's 1,800 psi of helium. Before we disconnect this, we write that on there, and we write the date. So if we get interrupted, we don't make a mistake. Then, relieving the pressure, we go over to the oxygen and do the same thing. This time, we use the digital gauge, or you can use the tear function on the digital gauge. But in any event, the same rule applies. Add the oxygen, record it before you disconnect. Turn this off, but before you disconnect the whip, make sure you've recorded both the gases that are in the tank. This is one of the most important things. Now, if you want to get an exact measure of your helium, which is totally unnecessary, helium's a far more friendly gas than nitrogen. It doesn't make any difference what helium's in the tank as far as the decompression goes. You could, right now, put an oxygen analyzer on here, get your percentage of oxygen, and then when you blow air back on top of this and measure it again, you'll be able to exactly calculate the percentage of helium. Helium is not as compressible as oxygen. This cylinder of oxygen, at the same pressure as this helium, will hold 330 cubic feet of oxygen, whereas the helium only holds 291 cubic feet. So you can see it's because, one, this is not as compressible as this. This argon is about like oxygen, it's about like air.
Okay, you just saw us mix the gas where we discussed putting the helium in first or putting the oxygen in first. Bill pointed out to me that most people don't have a digital gauge, and the range of the gauge is...
Yeah, these gauges tend to be accurate primarily within the mid-range, the boron tube type and the mechanical gauges. And so it's better to... in as much as the oxygen, the amount of oxygen added is a lot more critical than the helium is, that you want the optimum accuracy of the gauge. And oftentimes these can be off by as much as 100 pounds, which is, and sometimes you're adding 100 pounds of oxygen. So it's better to add the helium first if you're utilizing a mechanical gauge, and then they add the oxygen on top of the helium. Now, of course, one of the problems that you encounter is the helium generally is hotter, and it's in the process of stabilizing, so the process is a bit approximate. I mean, this question comes up quite often.
Well, in the middle of the range of the gauge, all we're looking for is the net change. Let's say to add 150 exactly. PSI of oxygen, it's not so bad. Even if the gauge isn't close to accurate, it should be the movement of 150 should be pretty good. What about the heat expansion? What kind of factor should we be, telling people to put in for a heat expansion factor if they put the helium in first?
We found that a 10% seems to work quite well. I mean, this is sort of an ad hoc conclusion, but over many of these fills, we found that doing a 10% overpressure seems to work out quite well. The mixtures come out fairly accurately.
So if we wanted 1,500 psi of helium, we'd make it really 1,650, and then if we want to add 150 psi of oxygen, we'd add 150 plus another 15 psi to get us...
Exactly. A very common mix that we use is 50% helium. This is a good mix to start with because you can later on blow air on top of it and still have a mix with an adequately high percentage of helium to be used for maybe not the same depth dive, but on subsequent dives. And I know this issue comes up when people are diving offshore for extended periods of time and they need to get the maximum utilization of their gas. So we found for a typical 50% helium mix, you can fill your tanks to 2,000 pounds, so that when the gas cools, you end up with about 1,800, 1,850 pounds. Now, the other problem that you run into, of course, is the helium. Unless you have a booster pump, helium typically comes in the 290, 300 cubic foot cylinders that are pressurized to around 2,400 psi. So it's important to try to keep the pressure as high as possible in your helium banks. But then this requires that you have a high pressure in your oxygen banks so you can add oxygen on top of that. So, and of course, you've seen how many bottles that we have. And one of the biggest arguments against using Trimix, of course, is the logistics in terms of having a sufficient number of helium bottles and oxygen bottles to properly mix the gas.
One of the big problems is that, and we mentioned it in the other part of the film, is that the helium is not as compressible as air or as oxygen. So you're not really getting as much volume of helium as you think you are just by the pure partial pressure. So, sometimes what we like to do is add additional helium to compensate for the lack of compressibility to actually get the higher percentage mixes. It's a critical difference, for example, between a 40 and a 50% helium mix as far as the air equivalent or narcosis equivalent depth on dives that are in the 300-foot range. 40% helium is extremely marginal, and if you have 40% just by the raw numbers, you don't really have 40% because the stuff, is not as compressible, and the heat factor, you may be looking more like 33%, which is totally inadequate. It's insidious because that would actually give you an equivalent narcosis depth in what we call the innocuous range, where we think there's no problem, the 100 to 150 foot range, the range that you can't feel the buzz, so to speak, and you think you're okay. That's the worst possible range for air diving, for example, because if you look at the accident statistics, this is where you have a tremendous number of cave accidents and a tremendous number of other accidents, all of which are totally inexplicable. And if you look at the excuses that are concocted to explain these accidents, they don't seem possible because you think, we all think, well, I wouldn't do anything that stupid. I mean, I wouldn't go in and run out of air and get lost on the main line in a cave or do any of these other things, but you'd be really surprised what happens when the certainty of a clear head is taken out of the picture. You're by yourself, something goes wrong. So it's extremely important that we found to get over any helium phobias And to look at these two compensatory factors that we're talking about, the heat expansion factor and the lack of compressibility factor, to really get your helium up to what we call the minimal acceptable level of air equivalent or narcosis depth, which, you know, for purposes of the Woodville Cars Plant project is, you know, has been set at 130 feet for nominal purposes, and in the case of oxygen, 1.4 partial pressure of oxygen. Actually, 130 feet is totally inadequate. We mix for the maximum depth that the dive is going to hit, and we actually fudge it more towards 100 feet air equivalent depth. So in the case of a Leon Sinks dive, a 300-foot dive, you know, some of these caves hit 320, so we're actually mixed for over 300 feet, and we actually are putting all these factors in. So quite frequently, our divers will be using oxygens that are extremely low in the 10 to 11% range, and heliums that are much higher in the 50 to 55, 60% real range. What about in mixing this gas? You know, Bill and I found another problem where we frequently forget to put the oxygen in the tank. The tank, it appears and feels like oxygen is being added when it's not. What causes that?
Well, what happens here is you fill the tank with helium and you put the oxygen line on the tank, and you have not dumped you've not purged the oxygen line. Now, what happens is that you don't actually turn the valve to allow oxygen to flow into the tank, and as you turn the supply tank, it's actually filling the oxygen line up to, because very often you're only adding 100 pounds or 120 pounds, say for 11 or 12% mix, which is not very much. So it appears to you that you're actually adding the oxygen to the tank when in fact all you're doing is adding oxygen to the supply line. And at any rate, this is one of the major reasons for analyzing your gas, because later on, after you've filled your gas, after you've added air to the mix, you'll notice that the percentage of oxygen is really too low. In fact, this begs the question, and that is that it might be a good idea, and we've started actually doing this, analyzing the pre-mixed gas, the helium and oxygen mix, before adding air to it as just an additional step. Very often, I know you've been asked the question numerous times, how do I know, you know, the percentage of helium in the mix? And of course, you know, one way to be absolutely certain of that is to analyze the percentage of oxygen right after you've added oxygen, and then of course analyze it again after you've added air, and you can calculate absolutely precisely.
One of the misconceptions of gas is the time it takes to mix. Obviously, the gas mixes immediately.
Especially helium, which is a highly mobile, very fast molecule. This is one of the reasons the transmissivity of helium, the heat transmissivity of helium, is quite high. This is why, because of the speed of the helium molecule being a small, you know, diatomic molecule. But
the opposite is true of argon. Yeah. You know, argon is a slow-moving molecule, so it doesn't transmit heat as well. So argon is a good dry suit gas. Helium, bad dry suit gas. Helium obviously will make, you know, transfer cold much more rapidly, or lose heat from the body much more rapidly. That's why, you know, rebreathers are nice with helium, because they'll tend to capture and recirculate that heat. But the fact is that the gas is little understood, but it mixes extremely fast. So if you did take a measure of your heliox, and let's say you have 5% heliox, and then and you blew air on top of it and came back with 10% Trimex, it would be a simple matter to, you know, set the two equations up to figure out what percentage of helium was in the final mix, since obviously you knew it in the first mix was 95%. So this is, for those who are concerned about this, and it's not really anything to be concerned about from a decompression point of view, because helium is a far friendlier gas for decompression purposes than nitrogen, but it certainly is important on some of these critical dives, especially the trickier dives, cold water dives, dark water dives, dives that are going to require some severe task loading, that you have adequate helium from our narcosis point of view. So from that point of view, and of course, in keeping with everything in the Doing It Right system, the more anal you are about all of this and the more meticulous and careful you are, and the more checks and balances you place on your gas mixing and on your whole dive plan, the greater probability that you're going to be successful and the lower the probability of having a problem develop.
And as you pointed out, we've, in our own practice, we've begun using helium mixes for almost all dives, even dives in the 100-foot range, that the additional cognitive enhancement that derives from using helium mixes, not to mention the improvement in decompression, the off-gassing and on-gassing, it just far outweighs whatever additional costs might be involved. And one of the big arguments I encounter from many people about why they don't want to use this, air is a lot more convenient, air is a lot cheaper. You have to weigh that against questions such as, you know, what is your life worth? Is your life worth an extra $5 for a dive? I mean, I look at people who've invested in so-called technical diving, and they have thousands and thousands of dollars in equipment. Very often the dive trip alone, if it's an offshore overnight trip, is running into the hundreds of dollars. So there's really no reason and no justification for not spending a few additional dollars to be diving a safer mix, especially when you're walking into the situation with both eyes open and knowing what the risks are. And as George had indicated earlier, that ocean diving and offshore diving is extremely dangerous, and it's filled with all sorts of uncertainties and risks and variables. And one of the least things you can do, of course, is to minimize risk wherever possible. And this certainly is part of the Doing It Right system, is where you know there's a risk, you do something about it rather than going into the dive and simply taking the risk. So,
having done that, assuming we've already mixed our gas, we'll go ahead and rig up like we're going to dive. I generally do is rig up my argon bottle. I pressure test the bottle first. I put a gauge on here, make sure the thing's full. You don't want to jump in without argon. You go down, can't inflate your dry suit and get a terrible squeeze, especially if you're relying on that for some of your inflation. Get that on and mount it upside down with these bands. And these bands can be purchased, you know, anywhere. Most of the stuff we get from Brownings, Third Long, or Halcyon, because it's made specifically to this type of diving. These things are, you know, these aren't just pony bottle straps. These are specifically made for argon bottles. We like to mount the argon bottle as far down the cylinder as possible. The reason being that in scootering along or in diving in a current, if the further down this way the bottle is, the less drag it's going to cause. The water's broken and the slipstream's running out like that. So if the bottle were up here, it's going to cause more drag. It's just like if you mount your tanks with the bands way down here and the tanks are sticking way up above your head, that's causing more drag than if the tanks are way down here. So we get the bands as high on the tanks as possible. We get anything on the tanks as far down as possible to create as much of a slipstream as we can. This is why we ride a tow-behind scooter. The tow-behind scooter tends to break the water in front of us. Same principle as swimming. You want to break the water in front of you and work in the slipstream. The next step is a set of wings. Now, in the first video, you remember we took the wings and reinforced them with a rubber inner tube. That's still a good idea. Now, of course, we're able to get wings made to our specifications, in which case we have this fixed on the back and sewn on. We have good heavy material on the outside, a good heavy material on the inside. So it's no longer necessary. I still do it, but it's no longer necessary. We finally come to the point where there's some gear manufacturers out there that'll make what we have found works rather than what they think works. The wings, you don't want too much height here. The wings, the lift needs to be down low on the tank. So that's important in setting these wings up. Now we'll put the harness on and then we'll go back and take a look at the harness. You notice we don't use any kind of bondage wings or bungeed wings or any other stupidity like that. Besides being obviously extremely dangerous, bungeed wings, they cause more drag, not less drag. Any rough surface is going to cause more drag. Just like a wetsuit, no matter how thick it is less drag than a shell dry suit because of the tautness of the fabric and the way the water rolls along it. Now look here, what happens when you inflate the wing, it goes back like that. It doesn't need to be bungeed up. And the fact is, the same amount of displacement is required to lift the same amount of weight. It doesn't make any difference whether it's bungeed up or whether it's smoothed back like that. The fact is, you want smooth, not bungeed. Also, you don't want anything on your gear that's convoluted, that's an entrapment, that's going to catch on things, whether you're cave diving or wreck diving, because it shows a sloppy mindset. And when you see something like that on another diver, you don't dive with them because that is the mindset that gets you killed. That's the mindset that causes accidents and problems underwater. So this is, whenever you see somebody with bungeed wings and bondage wings, you have a real good reason not to dive with them because you know up front what the problem's going to be. Now this is what the rig should look like. Clean, slick rig. No nonsense. As simple as possible. The wings only need to be about 45 pounds of lift. That's basically to start the dive with fully loaded tanks. These tanks are 9 pounds negative empty in fresh water. They're going to hold another 18 pounds of gas, or of air. We don't dive air, but if it's helium, it's going to be more like another 12 pounds of Trimix. And so with our stage bottles full, with our light, in our initial gear, that's our heaviest point of the dive. We want to be totally buoyant between our wings and our dry suit when we're diving steel tanks, obviously, so that if we have a problem at the beginning of the dive, just as if a jetliner takes off, it's full of fuel, it has a problem, it's got to dump its fuel before it can land. The same thing, when you start out, you want to have enough lift to be able to deal with what you're carrying, and that's the only reason. You don't need any great big amount of wings. In fact, the less is best in the case of the wings. Now let's take a look at this here. This is a pretty simple harness, pretty straightforward. Now let's take a look at why. Here's the actual harness. I'll show you how to weave the harness in a minute, but let's just put this thing on and see what we've got. Whether or not you scooter dive, you need a crotch strap. This holds the whole rig down. You don't want the rig floating up on your back. I'm using this buckle to hold the light on. We won't look at that right now. Let's do something else first. Let's just put it together. Basic features. Cut it, the line cutter, the knife, it should be right here. It has to be serrated. This is just like a gun in a gunfight. You want to pull the gun like that. You don't want to pull the gun out from back here, under here, from back here. You want the thing to come out like that. Because when you need it, you need it. And you need to know where it is, and it needs to not be cutting anything else or stuffed anywhere or any other nonsense. It needs to be right where it can be pulled. The backup lights. Down the strap here. Notice there's nothing on the front of the diver ever. This is where all the drag will come in. You have pouches or anything on your front. It's going to catch water with nothing here. Stuff on the sides already blocked by the shoulders and the other gear. Light, stage bottles, they're already in the slipstream. You only need one D-ring here, one D-ring here. These attach to this. This is just a piece of bungee cord here holding these lights in place. To deploy this light, you turn it on and then disconnect it. In any location where you have to pull the light out without being able to turn the light on first. If you drop the light, what are you going to do? If you need the light, just like when you need the knife, the light's got to be turned on, the light's got to be working, it can't be stuck someplace. It's also nice in using something like this, it'd be fairly simple to deal with, and nothing too complicated. One D-ring here. This is where we'll see what happens. Yes, where the pressure gauge goes.
This is where the stage bottle goes. The stage clips are that distance apart. On this side, we generally don't put stage bottles on the right. If you wanted to, though, the best bet is to use a piece of bungee down here, which holds the other bottle. Underwater, the bottle should be somewhat either side of neutrally buoyant, unless you're using steel stage bottles, which is insanity. It can therefore hang from a bungee right here. You don't want anything to hold your light on or restrict access to getting that light off.
Let's show what the light canister looks like. The light canister is going to slide on this way, all the way back like that. Again, it's out of the way. You can either hold it on by this buckle, or you can put the additional buckle on to hold it. But you don't want any D-rings blocking the way. If you need to get this thing off, you need to get it off. And one of the reasons you need to get it off open water diving is this is generally going to be 7 pounds negative. That's part of your weighting system. If you're having a problem, the light can go. In a cave dive, if you get keyed in a restriction, for example, by this light, you fit going this way, but now when you turn around coming the other way, the light's on the other side of the cave, you can't get through. It's a simple matter of drop the light off. Also, if you're having problems with it, pull it out and take a look, see if it's got water in it, not at the beginning of the dive. Not find out the hard way. I like to use an acrylic light canister, but for the wreck divers, we have the Barry Miller light. It's not a problem wreck diving with a Barry Miller light. This is unbreakable. Okay, let's look at how this harness is set up. This is one piece of material all throughout, other than the crotch strap. I just use one toe ring in the front. I don't use the back ring. I like to hook everything off to the front and push it through my leg so I can reach it. If I get in a jam, everything's right in front of me. But if you look at the way these straps go, you want them to come as close into your body as possible. Otherwise, you need a chest strap to hold this together. If these things are weaved behind, or if they're weaved in the wrong way here, you're going to need a chest strap. Now, let me show you how this thing has to be weaved. Taking a blank plate, this is the famous Lamar English plate. The webbing is coming through. If we can fit it through here. This thing was made from a stop sign or something. By the way, these plates are originally called Diver named Flanagan. I think it's from Ocala, and he made one of these from a stop sign, supposedly. That's the story anyway. But let's take a look. If this is behind us, okay, we want this to lay down along the body that way, okay? Go through the harness, the back plate, excuse me, in such a fashion that it's laying along the body still, see? Then back through this way and across. So you can see it's tight up against all the way. This is what holds the chest strap in so that when there's a stage bottle here, it doesn't pull off of your body. That's the whole trick to weaving one of these harnesses. Obviously, you have to put the D-rings on first and everything else. You can figure that out. But that's the direction. The webbing goes that way and then back out. If you put it on the outside or if you weave it the other way, you're going to need a chest strap. And if you don't need it, you don't put it on. Anything that clutters up your gear should be avoided. All right, let's go back to this rig. Let's start. I always put my long hose on first. It's just a thing with me. But this time I'm going to do it the other way because I'm going to show you why we do what we do. First of all, the backup rig. We'll put the backup on first. The backup regulator These regulators, by the way, have custom-built seats in them. because the other ones kept failing. They were built by Alex Baruxis, actually. And the pistons are custom machined pistons inside here. And the diaphragms I got from the Swedish brothers who sent them over to me from Sweden. So this rig is, and the stem is stainless steel, was made by Mike Trapani up in New Jersey. So I have a regulator that basically you can't buy. And unfortunately, there is no regulator that out of the box will do the job by itself. I want something that won't break off. It's DIN, that has a slow blows type of seat, and has the ports in a position I can use. So this is what I've got. It's a no name. Anyway, the key to this rig, we start with the backup regulator. It's not the safe second, it's not an octopus, it's a backup regulator. The backup regulator hangs around your neck. I take this plug. For certain types of dive, we dive some places that have like little sticks and shells in the water, and I plug it to get in the water so I don't get stuff into my backup regulator. However, all regulators must be able to come apart underwater in order to free them and clear the mushroom and clear the diaphragm, flip the mushroom over if they have a problem. This is an Apex regulator, made in England. Again, a no name. It's a custom built off of an Apex regulator. The backup hangs around the neck. Now the regulator feeds from right to left. All right, so this means it's going to be on the left post. Comes around, hangs there. Okay, we don't want it on this post over here with a hose out hanging, flapping the breeze. The hoses have to be tucked away. See, no hose sticking out anywhere. It's around the neck. The pressure gauge is on this side. Runs over the wings holding them down and is clipped off on that left D-ring. It can be reached scootering, can be reached with one hand. You don't have to move your light around. When you pick it up, the back glow, your light, you can see your pressure gauge. You don't have to take your light off to do it. You don't have to do anything. It comes out, you can see it. This is the post that turns off if you run across the ceiling. Everything turns off clockwise, turns on counterclockwise. That's the way everything should be. It's not any problem to figure that out. The thing is, if you get near something, you reach back and you check your valves. The thing about the backup rig is it will, in fact, be shut off if you turn your valve off and you don't know it. And your pressure gauge will be shut off. It'll hold its pressure. You have a bottom timer, you have a buddy. You have all kinds of checks on how much gas you have. If your gauge does the same reading twice, there's a chance that the thing's turned off. If you've gotten near something, there's a chance the thing's turned off. You have to turn it back on. Well, let's look at a solution to that. Okay, we go on to the long hose. We have the position of these two items. We want our other regulator to be obviously on the other post. So that solves the problem of why and where the two regulators go. The other regulator's on this post, okay? We use a 7-foot hose here, pretty much regardless of what we're diving. Anything shorter than that is too uncomfortable. Anything longer than that's too much hose. We run the 7-foot down behind the wings, out of sight, underneath the wings, underneath the light canister, back up, around the neck, into the mouth. When not in use, it's clipped like staging, it's clipped off right here, facing, you know, mouth facing into the breeze. By the way, the backup regulator should never be a high performance regulator, should never be an air balanced regulator. This is an unbalanced apex, a non-air balanced apex. This is a balanced, an air balanced apex, but it's somewhat detuned. It also has a couple of shutoff knobs here, you know, to slow it down a little bit. And the trick to a backup, it has to be non-air balanced so it doesn't free flow when it's turned up this way. And it also has to be close up to the neck. The further away from the neck, the more Venturi effect you're going to get pulling the gas out because the pressure is going to be lower. You want it to be tight up to your neck also so that If you don't feel good, you can jam it into your mouth. If you feel like you're going to talk, you can jam the thing in your mouth. That's not necessarily going to work, but it'll give you a warm, fuzzy feeling if you do it. Probably won't work. But there are situations where you want the reg held in your mouth, high, super fast current, you don't want the reg ripping out of your mouth. There's all kinds of situations where you might want to do that. But anyway, most of them are involving emergencies and air shares, by the way, or gas shares, by the way. Anyway, here's the position of the hose. Now, if you're in the water, this hose floats. So if you're in the correct position, the hose is floating up against you. If you're in this position, obviously the hose is going to want to go like this, but you're not supposed to be in that position. If you're decompressing in that position, you're not decompressing, because there's a significant pressure difference between your heart and the rest of your body. So if you're in this position and you're worried about the long hose floating up, that's the least of your concerns, because you're just wasting your time anyway. You need to be flat in the water, and you need, in fact, it's a good time to point out, you need to apply all your best diving skills no matter what kind of diving you're doing. Treat it all the same. Perfect neutral buoyancy, perfect body position, and there's all kinds of little subtle reasons why, like the decompression, like on-gassing and off-gassing, so on and so forth. Okay. So we have the position of the long hose. Now, check this out. Here's the inflator hose. This comes over to here, plugging in here. This comes down and goes through this bungee cord here. The bungee holds it in place. You always know where your inflator is. It's right here. You can always get it. Now, the thing about the inflator coming off of this post, one, I like to have my hoses crossed. I like to have everything neat, organized. I'm anal retentive. I have to have things that way. In my mind, everything has to have a logic and an organization. It's the only way I can do things. The only way I can dive. I have to have it that way. That alone is a good enough reason, because that means you're doing everything else properly in the first place. The other reason is that this thing also doubles as a regulator. In a pinch, you press both of these buttons at once. You can breathe off of that. It's a perfectly good regulator. You don't breathe back into it and breathe it like a rebreather. You breathe off of it, blow it out your nose, blow it out your mask. This hose here has to be long enough to reach your nose, your mouth, your dry suit valve. In other words, you need to be able to hold this and in one hand and be able to inflate both this and your dry suit valve, which is in your right here, and clear your ears without letting go of any of those items. When you're doing that, dropping down, you can switch your light to your right hand and hold it with your thumb so you're not flashing your buddy all around like that. But that's why you do it like that. That's why this rig is so simple and makes so much sense, because it's covered all these bases. You basically have three regulators split between two posts. And you have the backup around the neck, and you have the long hose here. The other thing, too, is that you don't want to find out that your left post isn't turned on by not having your inflation, by sinking into the silt in a cave or down, you know, while you're trying to clear your ears and while your scooter's running away or while everything else is going on, because that's a bad time, you know, because you still have to go turn it back on. So if your inflator's on this side, that doesn't happen. All you're going to lose is your pressure gauge and your backup regulator, but you have another regulator that works perfectly well, and you have your inflation. And you know how much gas you got because you know your breathing rate, you know your depth, and you know your time. And you know that if you read the same reading twice on your gas and you're breathing off of it, that the thing is turned off or the pressure gauge is stuck. So you look at your buddy's gauge. So that tells you where you stand. You look at your time. The whole trick to this is it's got to be dead nuts simple. There can't be any convolution, complication, and it can't be any efforts to solve phobias or fight demons that don't exist. This is a clean and simple rig, the way it should be. Okay, the light, as we saw, the light is going to be right here. This is a Bill Gavin style light where the light plugs in one direction, is unplugged in the other direction. It's keyed in the bottom. It's a nice piece of equipment. The light handle, the Goodman handle, allows you to operate and have the light in the same hand. What I said before about switching the light over to the right thumb, dropping down, so you're not flashing, you know, like going like this with your light. We have a clip. We always clip the light off. Whenever we change a stage bottle, we stop. We never let the light hang down. It's just sloppy behavior, sloppy practice. It goes in the silt, you can't see. Besides, you should always be flat with the head up. With this like this, so you can see what Buddy's doing, because that's when you're changing bottles and when you're doing something is when something's likely to go wrong. So that's when you want to be paying the most attention. That's when you want to have all your stuff organized and neatly together. If you're not using something, it needs to be parked. You don't turn the light off, because you don't want to risk blowing the bulb, turning it back on. But you don't let it hang down to catch on something, to sink in the silt, to get tangled, to where you put your hose, you know, you don't hang it around your neck when you're changing bottles, because then you put your stage bottle in and it's underneath your thing, you go to pull it off, and you just have a huge mess, rip the regulator out of your mouth. You just need to go take time, do things slowly and carefully and methodically every time. Now the big killer really in diving, besides rule number one, which is don't dive with strokes. Besides diving with strokes, the biggest risk in diving, or whatever you want to call it, sophisticated diving, gas diving, is breathing the wrong gas. And it's essential that we come up with a method that that gives us every opportunity not to do that. Now, what we do in a case like this, we leave the back tanks marked and dated all the time, and we indicate the pressure and whether they're full or not. But the tanks aren't painted or permanently marked anywhere on the doubles. What is permanent is our choice of decompression gases and our stage bottles or our bottom mix. It's well worth your while to paint the maximum operating depth on your bottles, whether you intend to use them once or 100 times at that depth. It's so easy to take some PVC cleaner or some solvent and knock that paint off and put a new one on. The magic marker has to be large letters. It has to be 3-inch high letters horizontally in the orientation of the tank on either side of the tank, so that no matter where the diver is carrying the bottle, his buddy can see what the maximum operating depth of that bottle is in his breathing. So starting with the deepest bottle. Show how to rig the bottles in a second. The 300-foot bottle. The bottle says 300 no matter where you look at it. It says 300 feet. So if I'm diving at 300 feet and I've got, you know, a 120 bottle on, there's a problem. My buddy can see it. The stage bottles are generally, well, we'll talk about that in a second. The next bottle that we happen to use is the 190 bottle. The 190 bottle, in this case, is 1933 Trimix. We decompress on Trimix. Helium's a much friendlier gas. We don't want to be loading up the nitrogen at depth. This one has the null over it. Then we get higher, we've got the 120 bottle. The 120 bottle is 35% oxygen, can be Trimix or it can be Nitrox. This is not 120 to dive, this is 120 to decompress with gas on the back. It's obviously at 120 feet, 35% Nitrox is a 1.6 partial pressure of oxygen, which is too much for diving. It's even a little bit high for decompression. It's the maximum you want to run into for decompression on a dive like this, but here's this bottle's newer and you can see it has my name. It's on this side, you can see the depth. It's on this side, you can see the depth. I leave the tape on the tank, I'm gonna take it off right before I get in the water, but right up here in the neck, I also write the depth, 120. This one I wrote 240, this one says 300. Then the next bottle up from that is the 70-foot bottle. This is the 50% Nitrox or Heliox or Trimix, whatever you want, the 50% oxygen, same situation. We found these to be the most efficient gases for decompression. Some form of deep Trimix, some form of Trimix or Nitrox from 120 feet, some form of Nitrox or Trimix from 70 feet, and then of course the oxygen. Now with the oxygen, the oxygen needs to also say oxygen on it as well as 20 feet, because 20 looks like 70. Generally, we use the steel bottles for the oxygen. We're higher up in the water column. This is in cave. In salt water, you don't need to use steel. You use aluminum oxygen bottles. But they need to say oxygen on them if they have oxygen so they don't get confused with anything else. Extremely important. Rig these bottles. This is extremely simple. Starting down here, this is just a hose clamp. This is just a stainless steel bolt snap. You want to use stainless steel. You don't want to use any kind of other thing. Brass cuts your fingers. Stainless is it never doesn't rust. It's much more simple. You can use gigantic ones like these if you've got gloves and salt water, or you can use little bitty ones if you're in the fresh water. All this is looped through the bottom, tied here. Now watch this. This is what makes it so simple. The rig is nothing. It's dead nuts simple. You run it through a piece of this. This is only a handle for underwater. You take it up here, you tie it around the neck of the tank in such a fashion that this clip is right at the break of the tank. This will give you the least amount of drag. If you've got the bottles anywhere else, down low, it's just gonna cause a lot of drag. It's just gonna be a huge mess. If the bottle pulls away from you like that, it's maximum drag. The bottle needs to be tight up here and free to move at the tail. The bottle needs to be a Luxfer Aluminum 80. 3 pounds negative when full of air, 3 pounds positive when out of air. Trimix, obviously, the swing is less negative, more positive. You want a lot of room on this loop, tight on this loop. You want it to be able to move. You want it tight, but you want it to be able to find its own slipstream. Stuff is extremely simple when done properly. There's no reason to complicate it. You never want a metal-to-metal connection on a stage bottle. That's insanity. You get stuck on something, you can't get rid of the bottle. You get stuck with this, you pull out your knife and cut the stupid thing off. And you know, everybody says, well, you know, you guys just dive cave, you don't dive wreck. It's not going to happen in a cave. It's going to happen in a wreck. As many cave dives as I've done wreck dives, I'd be 200 years old by the time I equal them up. It's not possible. We live here on the ocean, we dive year-round, we have all kinds of things to dive on. We have the Gulf Stream, it's a 3.5 knot to 4 knot current. We have all kinds of natural and unnatural shipwrecks full of fishing lines and wire and everything else. And we all have extreme weather conditions. You drop down, there's no current. 10 minutes later, it's howling 3.5 knots. You can't pull against it. You get stuck on things. You get pinned to things. We have oil rig towers get pinned on. There's all kinds of things. What we found, wreck diving, applies to but more so to wreck diving. I don't have a scooter. I run 3.5 knots. I run 2 knots. They run 1 knot if I had a convoluted gear. If we're diving wreck, we're diving salt water. We don't want to use the steel tanks or these great big bottles. You should never expose yourself to an unnecessary bottom time in the ocean. Go to the aluminum 80s, the workhorse of ocean diving. If you're wearing a wetsuit, you never want to wear steel tanks in the ocean. You get down deep, the suit compresses, you lose your buoyancy. You want to use these and a weight belt. Ditch the weight, these go. The 280s with air are going to be negative 6 pounds, positive 6 pounds empty. You throw on a weight belt, you're light, or no light, more weight if you don't have the light. If you have a problem, you can get rid of the weight belt, you can get rid of the light, but you can get up even with the full tanks. With steel, you're not going to be so lucky unless you've got, you know, unless you're wearing a dry suit. If it's cold water, you should be wearing a dry suit in the first place, not two or three sets of wings or double bondage wings or lead stupidity. The correct thing is to balance your rig up front before you get in the water. And the other thing is, in keeping with not incurring a large decompression liability in the ocean, with, you know, the fish, the weather, the boat traffic, everything else, you also want to have small decompression bottles that are manageable. All we do is the same thing in miniature. 40 cubic foot bottles, the 120 bottle, the 70 bottle, and the 30-foot aluminum of oxygen. That's all the oxygen you need in the water. If you need more oxygen than that, you just did too long a bottom time. But it's quite simple to have these two or three bottles with you. If you put a bottle here, the way these 40s operate, if you clip one here or two here, the tail of them tends to float, and they're out of the way back here. And you can switch. You breathe this one, bring this next one up, bring the next one up. So the way I do it and it works out perfectly. It's a whole lot better. These three little guys, this is a deep dive too, where I got to use all these gases, as opposed to this in the ocean. These three and this, more likely you're going to be using the 70 and the oxygen with this in the ocean. A nice clean rig.
As we mentioned on the tape, the long hose floats up against the body, and we touched on the concept that the person needs to be horizontal in the water. And I mentioned there that you're not decompressing if you're not horizontal. This is extremely important, and the thing that you have to know about the position of the lungs and the importance of the lungs is the lungs is your last defense against getting bent. If you didn't have a good filter system in the form of dioxide, you did, and you would be immediately killed. The worst possible thing you can have is a pulmonary shunt. The worst possible thing you can have happen is for bubbles to get past the lungs. The lungs are filtering bubbles. In the final stages of decompression, which are when you get out of the water and onto the boat, the last of the bubbles are going to be released by that last pressure differential. And when that occurs, your only line of defense is the filter mechanism set up by the lungs. So, if we're horizontal versus vertical, we need to look at the difference in the amount of protection you're providing yourself with that filter. It's no accident that strokes have problems diving. It's no accident that the same people with the same sloppy performance, the same sloppy gear, the same sloppy mindset, the same nonsense are the ones that get bent, that get hurt, that get lost, that get killed. It's no accident. But why is it well understood? Bill, when you're a biomedical engineer, you understand the human body incredibly well. In fact, you do most of the advising for the Woodville Cars Plane Project and all of us on how we conduct a lot of these things. Can you explain that in a way that people can understand the importance of the position of the lungs?
Indeed. The pulmonary perfusion, your lungs, the gravitational difference, the difference in head, in hydrostatic head between the top of the lungs, the apex of the lungs, and the lower lobes of the lungs, is significant. And in the vertical position, the capillaries at the upper part of the lungs tend to collapse through the capillary bed, the alveolar capillary complex in the lower part of the lungs. Now, obviously, when this happens, you're not maximizing the perfusion in your lungs. You're not maximizing the gas transfer capability of your lungs. Also, of course, you're not utilizing the full filtering effect of your lungs. However, when you're in the supine position, your blood now, of course, flows through your entire lungs, and you're getting all of the benefits of gas transfer through all of your alveolar sacs. So this is why in decompressing, obviously want to maximize, wherever possible, gas exchange. So certainly keeping in the level, in the horizontal position is really very important. And you can see this. This is well described in most texts in physiology, that how the perfusion of the lungs changes with the orientation of the lungs. So
the other thing too is that we know from practical experience that decompressing in an air or a gas environment as opposed to a water environment provides a much cleaner decompression. Obviously, if we're standing here in this room, and this room is at 30 feet under the surface, and is pressurized at 2 atmospheres, we feel the same 2 atmospheres all over the body, no matter what position we're in, because the pressure in the gas space is uniform. In a fluid-filled space, obviously, it would be according to the hydrostatic head. Now, the thing you have to consider: high percentage oxygen decompression gases in the water. Is that we've also discovered, and we haven't discovered it, we've known it for years from evidence, is that human beings apparently can tolerate a greater partial pressure of oxygen in a gas space than they can in a water space. A lot of that probably has to do not only with the physical pressure, but with the uneven pressure throughout the body and the stresses that puts on the circulatory system and the uneven nature of the loading. It again makes a lot of sense that if you fall back to the basics, which is basic buoyancy control and good body position, that there's a good chance that you're not only improving your decompression but lowering your decompression risk. The real risk of decompression isn't getting bent; it's toxic. And if you have incurred a dive, or if you've incurred a dive where your physical condition doesn't warrant incurring the decompression liability, you've incurred a risk that's been incurred totally unnecessarily. So these are some of the factors you have to consider when you're discussing making a decision about doing this kind of diving, and we'll get to that later. But this goes back to our, the thing I mentioned about the long hose floating up against the body. You don't care about the hose floating up this way because you're not supposed to be in a vertical position in the water for so many different reasons and for so many different potential reasons, the logic of which is better than the empirical evidence would indicate. The when you look at these hoses, before we get into, I don't want to forget to mention this one thing. You have the long hose that when we're not using it, we clip it off to the D-ring, and we clip the light off. When you're talking about losable equipment and safety equipment versus non-safety equipment, this will determine the method of tie-off that you use. For example, on a pressure gauge or a long hose, there's a possibility in the case of a pressure gauge, you get hung up on something and you got to get it loose. Well, you never have anything you can't cut. You never put a clip around your hose, like a double ender around your hose and to your D-ring. That's insanity. What are you going to do, cut the pressure gauge hose? You can't do that. You can't have metal to metal or uncuttable. You can use the cave line, which you can cut, but maybe a better solution would be what Jared Jablonski came up with, which is putting a little breakaway in there. What he does is put a little O-ring, ties a little O-ring in there that he can break away if he gets hung up. The same thing applies to the long hose. On the long hose, if that clip off here, if you have a situation where you have to donate the hose and you're diving stage, obviously, you always donate the regulators in your mouth. And sometimes that will be the stage. That would be your first instinct. You have to be willing to do that all the time. But a good diver is going to anticipate the problem. If you're changing stage bottles and you're looking at your buddy, or you're on a stage bottle and you can see your buddy's having a problem, you're ready with the hose, the real long hose. And, of course, the long hose is almost always a breathable gas. If you're having a problem with decompression, that's totally, it's a totally different subject matter. However, in the possible case where you need to get the hose and you've got it clipped off, you want to have some form of breakaway. And there's two ways of doing that. Again, this is non-losable equipment because it's attached to the end of the, attached to your person. It's not going to go away. You could action on a tie wrap breaks it away. Or the Jablonski O-ring situation would work. You don't want to have to pull your knife, cut your hose off to donate it. But again, you can be donating from your mouth. And yep. You also have to be willing to donate from the mouth, but you have to think all these possibilities and things through. You don't want to get stuff hung up on you that's attached to you that you can't cut like a hose. The other type of attachable, of course, is the non-losable, like the backup light. That you need to be tied on with cave line. You don't want to tie wrap, because if you try this, if you twist a bolt snap or whatever with a tie wrap, it'll break right off. So we have to distinguish between lose and no lose when it comes to gear. Your safety spool is a no lose. Your backup lights are a no lose. Your pressure gauge is a lose because it's obviously attached to you. It's not going to go anywhere. It may be annoying if it's loose, but it's not going to go anywhere. And of course, again, it floats back. And except in the case of extremely heavy ones. We mentioned inflators. We mentioned breathing off the inflator. What I didn't mention and needs to be mentioned is you do not want an air balanced inflator mechanism or a high-speed inflator. Again, you have to anticipate your buoyancy needs as you go down. You don't drop down and hammer your inflator, and you don't, so you wouldn't need a high-speed inflator. You don't want a high-speed inflator because you don't want the thing running away on you, And on the other side of the coin is you can't use it for anything else. For example, you can't breathe it if it's got a, you know, some kind of rocket ship delivery. The other thing is you don't want wings that are elastic or restricted with elastics for the same reason. If you try to use your that as a regulator, every time you hit the discharge button, it's going to, the elastic is going to be trying to blow this gas out. Also, conversely, if you lost that hose and you can't, and you want to use the inflator, you want to inflate by mouth, you're not going to be able to inflate against, you know, without causing extreme lung loading and potential damage. So this is not, you know, the kind of thing you want on dive gear. It's, again, it's the kind of thing that was created by people that don't really dive and haven't thought the thing through, and what they're trying to do is go with the fishing lure effect. They're trying to make lures that look good to fishermen, not to fish. And they're trying to attract customers in the store, not follow any line of logic. The system we use has to follow all lines of logic and all lines of reasoning, has to work in all situations, circumstances, and it all has to fit together. And that's why, you know, these little details are extremely important. Now look, let's look at the position of the hoses on the manifold. The real risk of manifold diving and the real failure mode isn't that the manifold breaks and loses your gas. It's extremely difficult to break one of these things. It's just a big hunk of machinable brass. I mean, you can break it, you can blow O-rings, but by the time the gas leaks out of the tanks, it's going to be 3 or 4 days later. The real failure mechanism is to break a knob off and then to lose a regulator, to have a regulator begin free flow. On this side, the right side, on the left side, the failure mode is to roll the thing off and break it off and not have access to that regulator. That's the real failure mode over there. The isolator tends to solve half the problem. In other words, if it's a case of losing the gas from a runaway regulator with the knobs broken off, the isolator will, you know, give you a shot at saving half the gas once you get it shut down. Don't leave it partially shut. Leave it all the way open because you don't want to run into the risks of, you know, a bad fill or, you know, some kind of... Leave it open all the time. You can turn it off fast enough. If you don't believe me, go try to dump your tanks and see how fast, long it takes to dump the tanks out of, you know, the left port while you're trying to shut the isolator, for example. It's insignificant to the risk, the real risk, which is, you know, making a gas mixing error that'll kill you. So, looking at these two things, okay? We have the long hose on this post. Some people have tried to put the long hose over on the left post. Well, you know, this isn't well thought out. The left post is, of course, the one that rolls off. Now, 90% of the time, if you hit something, if you get near something, you're going to roll it. If you hit something, you're going to break it off. If you roll it off and break it off, you don't have a long hose anymore, and you can't donate it. The same reason, you know, we put the backup inflator over here, because it acts like another backup reg. If indeed the true failure mode occurs, which is going to occur most of the time when you hit something, which is roll off, break off, you've lost your backup regulator and your pressure gauge, but you have another backup regulator and a donatable regulator. So you still, you have to turn the dive, obviously, but you're still in the ball game. You can still function and can solve the problems that are the genesis of the redundant system in the first place, having two regulators and being able to share gas. There's other obvious situations. You don't want to be sharing gas on something that can roll off. You don't want to panic a guy who's having a problem. 99% of the time, the other guy is not out of gas. He just thinks he's out of gas. He's having a temporary problem with his gear, or his something is turned off, or his wasn't turned on, or there's some problem with the regulator, or he's having trouble getting to something, or he's got something messed up. He isn't actually out of gas, so wetting this is not really a genuine problem. It's a perceived problem, and you go to solve it. You don't solve it correctly, and it turns into a problem. If you aren't able to immediately donate gas to a diver who's having a problem and get him calmed down, he is going to turn around and cause a much bigger problem than already exists, whether there really was an underlying problem or not. So you see what I'm saying? That these things have to be considered in advance. Additionally, from a less threatening point of view, obviously the calmer you can keep the situation, the greater the chances of pulling the dive off. I mean, you don't want to go up, you know, 50 miles offshore to a wreck dive and have your buddy freaked out because he forgot to turn a regulator on all the way or something like that, and he thinks there's a problem, and his day is ruined, and he just wants to call the dive. If you can control and calm the situation, you've saved yourself, you know, a dive. At best. At worst, you know, in a worst-case situation, you've saved a guy's life. So these things have to be considered well in advance. A lot of people want to argue with the way that we do things. A lot of people want to come up with something better. Everybody wants to make their mark in diving. We did not invent any of this. This is the oldest, simplest commercial diving thing in the world. When I first got out of college, which is a significant number of years ago, I worked for a corporation and I had the purchasing manager buy me some scuba gear. And the regulator came with a necklace for the backup. And that's what we're diving today. So I didn't invent it. Bill Gavin and Bill Main didn't invent it. It's always been that way. It's obvious. It's a backup regulator. You know, these are just the simplest, clearest, most obvious things. It's marketing in the dive industry that later has created, you know, bizarre buoyancy devices and safe seconds and stuffed hoses and bondage wings and stupidity to do with basic diving. So when you look at these things where somebody says, well, put the regulator on the other post and comes up with a lot of dumb reasons for it, just say no, because the system is not well thought out. Now, in going back to why, you know, we already talked about why the choice of regulators. We start with the backup, ending up with the long hose on the right side. But let's look at what this does. The putting the hose there and having it around the neck and always in position and always deployable and out in the open is an accommodation to several things at one time and a solution to several problems at one time. We don't want to stuff this hose someplace and have it so that we need our buddy to put it back if it gets loose, or we have to pull it to try to free it and have it all kinked up, or so it's in the way of other gear, so it's causing more drag. It's so simple and clean to have the thing in position in the first place, and it solves so many problems. There's no question about, you know, you don't need anybody's help to put it away. You don't need anybody's help to stow it. You don't need to worry about it. There's no question that it's working and so on and so forth. And it's not going to free flow and you not know it. And we've looked at all the ways that has to be accommodated and mixed in with the other gear. The lights on that side, because if the scooter is controlled from the right side, so you don't scooter dive. Well, the two bottles on one side is a lot slicker than bottles going like this on the other side. And then you say, well, I'll attach the bottles tightly to me. Then where does the light go? Where does everything else go? Now you're going to have some kind of attachment point that's going to hold the light on. So what if you need to get the light off? See, all these things have to be thought through. The fact is that when you're swimming and you scull through the water with your hand, doing for you if it's sloppy. If you have two stage bottles, they're doing their own thing, slowing you down, whether it be you're hanging onto a line in a 2.5-knot current in the Gulf Stream, or whether you're scootering along in a 2 knots in a kit. So a lot of the real genesis of what we've come up with is as a function of the wreck diving and the ocean, open ocean diving that we've done. And this, of course, has been the greatest learning ground for risk analysis and assessment, and really identifying the risks of some of these dives. We've already discussed the position of the hoses. I think we've made it clear why we do what we do there. The thing that Bill and I, you know, frequently run into, and especially going on dive boats or dealing with ocean diving and dealing with offshore diving, diving Bahamas banks, diving in the Gulf Stream, is really identifying what the real risks of the dives are. And this applies. Cave diving is easy to analyze the risks. It's extremely easy. Everybody immediately, whether they've ever gone in a cave or not, knows the risks. The risks of getting out. The ocean is not so obvious. I mean, you go out there, it's a nice, beautiful, sunny day. It's flat, calm. It's beautiful, glassy, warm, you know, suntan weather. And then the current changes, the weather changes. An ocean-going tugboat comes down towing a barge 900 feet behind it with a cable the size of a telephone pole going 15 knots right over your decompressing divers. You get it, you know, fish schools of fish come through with the tunas and the sharks, and the situation, suddenly there's a huge algae bloom. There's jellyfish everywhere, and you're getting stung. These are all, you know, the kind of changing things in situations. But divers get injured, divers get lost, divers get separated, divers get bent. There's a lot of situations that develop. The trick is to identify the real risks. What a lot of people don't believe is that a couple of short bottom times are a lot better than one long bottom time in the ocean.
Absolutely. That's a good question. I mean, there's certainly, as you pointed out and itemized, you know, many of these risks, and of course all of these risks essentially add up to not being in the water or minimizing the amount of exposure you have in the water, and certainly running up large decompression obligations is expanding the level of risk tremendously. But what we found is that by minimizing one's bottom time or keeping it within a reasonable window of time where the amount of decompression and the risk of having to blow off the decompression, and there have been many examples over the years of situations where people have gotten lost off of wrecks, and particularly in the Northeast where the visibility is bad, the boat is moored on the wreck, the idea of having to drift and decompress away from the boat for a long period of time, like if the fog rolls in, you're out on the Andrea Doria, and the seas kick up and the weather changes, I mean, you're gone. You're history. So you're forced under these circumstances to go right to the surface. What we found is that the damage that's done to you by completely avoiding all your decompression is a lot less. I mean, it would be better to be in a wheelchair or to be uncomfortable or have pain in your joints. This is a correctable problem. Maybe being in a wheelchair is a correctable problem, but you're still alive. And we've seen in normal circumstances where the fear of having to do a long decompression has caused people to drift, you know, a long ways from the boat to the point where, and now you have a situation where you have other divers who are decompressing, the boat can't move, nothing could be done for you, and in what started out as a reasonable endeavors is run away into a huge problem. So by keeping your bottom times within a reasonable time frame, say 20 or 25 minutes, even for a 250-foot dive, you're still not looking at much more than 45 minutes to an hour, maybe slightly more decompression. And then maybe later on, after a reasonable surface interval, doing another one of those dives rather than doing one extremely long dive, and then your decompression is absolutely essential. And then the adherence to the precise decompression schedule becomes much more critical as well. On a short dive, there's a huge amount of flexibility in the amount of decompression you have to do or you can get away with doing. Not necessarily recommending doing this, but it's as Trey has said, the risks, so many times you go into something like this and you only find out about the risk after the problem has occurred. And part of this flying in advance and thinking through these risks before throwing the equipment on and jumping in the water and having to deal with the consequences of this afterwards.
I mean, a lot of people, too, is they're relying on decompression as an in-water treatment, so to speak, from the profile that they've done. They're failing to do the deeper stops. I mean, rather than argue decompression methods or techniques, let's just take what everyone generally seems to accept, and that is the Bowman model, as opposed to the Navy model. Let's call the Navy model a go-up-and-treat, and the Bowman model a gradual decompression. If you look at the Bowman model, almost nobody's following it. The Bowman ascent rate at 30 feet a minute is the equivalent of doing a 10-foot stop every 20 seconds. So if you're doing a 300-foot dive, you have a 290, 280, 270, 260 every 20 seconds. And you're not doing that. Most people are not doing that. So what's happening is they're coming up, and then they're going for that Bowman ceiling because they've been taught fear of helium, fear of decompression, fear of this, fear of that, phobias, and a lot of other nonsense. And what they've done is now forced a treatment situation upon themselves by failing to adequately decompress from the deeper depths, which is a matter of, you know, adding 3 minutes to what they would have done. And again, all we're doing is saying, you know, look at the Bowman model a little more closely. It's calling for stops. If you treat those as stops, meticulously, like everything else you should be doing, meticulously, anally, and carefully, a lot of these problems won't exist. So if we do our deeper stops as we come up, and then we identify the correct point to make gas switches, we don't use like these useless gases up at shallow depths and things like that. Shorter bottom time that we've stuck with a shorter bottom time. We've done the deeper section of decompression adequately, so we're not in need of treatment at every stop, or as we hone in on the Bowman ceiling, we're not treating ourselves and badly in need of oxygen. We get up to that point, and if at that point something is going wrong, above or below, or we're off the line or we're lost, now we got a shot at breaking to the surface, yelling to the boat, I'm over here, going back down and doing the decompression, as opposed to coming up, panicking, and shooting to the surface already in need of treatment. So these are some of the things that have to be thought about. Now, obviously, these things are going to happen. You're going to get separated from your body. You're going to get off the wreck. You're going to go. These things are all going to happen. It would be nice if they didn't. It would be nice if everybody went into these dives with a buddy, with a dive plan, told the captain of the boat about it. You know, everybody did cave dives with buddy. Everybody was conscientious about sticking with buddy, watching out for buddy, keeping buddy calm and happy. That a lot of these things would be self-eliminating. However, things go wrong. If we've already identified that the real risk is doing like a 50-minute bottom time at 220 feet on the Andrea Doria and then getting lost off the wreck and skyrocketing to the surface in a fog and a rainstorm, the boat's off trying to find somebody else, or, you know, the thing is cut loose from the mooring, or, you know, you're using a John line and it breaks, whatever the situation is, you know, or an upline, a Jersey upline and it breaks, whatever the situation is, you've done a cave dive, you can't find your buddy, whatever the case. Somebody's taking your decompression gas. If up front you've made some decisions that minimize some of these risks effectively without even having them occur, then of course if some of the other things we see in this kind of diving is the concept of mismatched tanks. You know, we get these guys, you know, you see people that say, well, I'm really good at gas, you know, so I'm going to dive, you know, these little tanks, or there'll be a female and they'll say, well, you know, I'm really good at gas, so I'm going to dive little tanks with my, you know, 280-pound boyfriend or whatever who's diving, you know, twin 160s and is a horrendous hoover. And we try to come up with these convoluted gas comparison methods. First of all, you don't dive with anybody that's not willing to wear the right gear in the first place. It's rule number one. You don't dive with strokes. Only a stroke would show up saying that they're so good on gas that they're going to dive little tanks with you. We're at the upper end of the good on gas scale. We don't do that. You know, and there's nothing to prove by good on gas. The only way you're going to be any good on gas is if you've done the physical exercise and you're able to relax and you've been diving forever. And on and on and on and on and on. And then, it's a small matter of differential. The fact is, the correct calculation is the worst breathing rate applied to a third of the smallest tanks. So, backing up to where's the real risk. Do we go into a dive like that? Do we go like, say, well, I've got this horrendous hoover over here, and he's going to dive with his, you know, 60-pound girlfriend, and she's wearing, you know, a pair of, doubled up aluminum 40s. So where do we turn the dive? We turn the dive at the dock. And
yeah. I mean, this is, you're absolutely right. Another point on long, why not to have long bottom times is, number one, one of the problems we've seen, particularly this has been implicated in some of the more egregious fatalities, because they had too much gas on them. They had too many bottles, and by minimizing your decompression time, minimizing your bottom time, you can get by with the smaller bottles. You're less than the 40 cubic foot or the 30 cubic foot bottles. You're less encumbered. You're more mobile in the water, and it just the dive is more enjoyable, as well as safer.
If you're not in overhead, and you're not diving a wreck, and you're not diving any long bottom time or deep or anything else, and you don't need the redundancy, just we go to the same rig on a single tank that we have on a double tank, only there's only one regulator, one first stage regulator. You don't need two regulators of redundancy if you're only at 100 feet or whatever. The same thing. We have the same harness, the same wings, only smaller. Everything about the harness is identical. The pressure gauge is over here, the inflator's over here, the backup rig's hanging around the neck, and here's the long hose, which is just a, you know, a longer version, which comes up like that, under the shoulder. Same rig, and you know, if you can use the longer hose if you like, but that's a pretty good reach for gas sharing if need be. But it's identical rig. Weight belt, single 80, slick and clean. You can use the same plate and everything for the that goes over here. Now, looking at some of the other little details that we talked about last time, we still like the fin straps with the cord inside with the spring. These are attached with a clamp here. You can just get nickel wire and attach them if they come with some other mechanism that looks like it'll rust out. You know, made by a dive equipment company. This is a standard spring. You can go to the hardware store and buy this. It has a loop in the end. You can attach it here with wire. This won't get caught in lines or anything. It's silly. But it won't break. That's the reason to use it. It's not going to break and lose your fins in the middle of a dive. That backup light we looked at is the 3C cell backup light. This one is an Oceanic, which is not made anymore, but Barry Miller makes the same light. It's got to be non-rechargeable, alkaline. You throw them away and get new ones. You check it with a voltmeter. It has to work every time. You never use the backup light for anything but backup. A lot of people like to carry a spare mask. I carry a spare mask. Simply because scootering, you know, for hours to get out of a cave without being able to see would not be too much fun. All I do is take one of these free diving masks, any kind of free diving mask, clip it in my pocket of my dry suit with the glass facing my body. Don't put it in, stick it on the outside of your gear. The other thing is we don't ever use the computers. The best computer in the world is right here. Just use a bottom timer. Just a standard bottom timer and depth gauge. It's usually on the right wrist. Put the compass on the left, or you can do it either way. Safety spool for cave diving goes in the pocket as well. That way you can't lose it. The interesting thing about this is that the clip that holds it on also holds the line, so you can't lose your safety line. You can have a mess, but you won't lose. These things, by the way, are made by the same guy that makes the stems for the stainless steel stems for DIN regulators, Mike Trapani. This one I made myself, but Mike makes a version of this. For cave diving, we use the one-way reel. Line goes off, but it doesn't go on. Actually, you can put line back on with this one, but this one's made for losing line, not facing backwards. Anyway, this is Bill Gavin reel. Barry Miller makes these reels now. On the mask, the thing we found on the mask, you've got to make it so it doesn't get stuck on stuff, so it slides off and on over the head easily. So I just use this, you know, the stretch strap rather than the plastic. Same thing, the plastic would break. These things won't break. Rather than use magnifying lenses on the mask, I use a powerful contact lens in one eye for surveying to read the gauges up close. I used to use the other, but this is much far more effective. This is a converter for a rebreather. I want to convert a regular bottle to a rebreather bottle. Not relevant here at all. The stage bottle regulator is really simple. The ones that we like best are these Scuba Pro pistons. These are, this is a, they've got several versions of it. I always just buy the 20s or the 15s, but I think the 10, there's 10, there's other ones, they seem to be the same. Anyway, the piston swivels on a stage, just makes it more convenient to have a swiveling regulator on a stage bottle. I don't like it on my back. That's just my way. I just don't like the concept. I've never, you know, I don't have any problems with these things. I've got 40 of them. But anyway, the this is just a piece of bungee cord. That's all this is, holding this pressure gauge back up here behind the regulator. This one is convertible either way, but you see what it looks like. It's pretty small and pretty slim. The I use the higher performance regulators, the G250 air balance regulators on these, because I'm not concerned about blowing them, because I can control the tank with a valve. It's a stage bottle. Also, when you've got all my stage regulators are the same. There's no nitrox, none of that silliness, oxygen, any of that nonsense. They're all identical regulators. The nice thing about these for a decompression style regulator is the amount of time you got to breathe it. So you wait. My rule is the longer I got to breathe the regulator, the more high performance and the easier breathing I want. So that's why, when I get up to oxygen and nitrox and upper levels longer times, I go with these Scuba Pro regulators. They're more Ferrari-ish in that they're more sensitive and they're more sensitive, have to be cared for differently. But on the other hand, you're not going to find anything that breathes any better. And certainly, the other reason that we use the piston-style Scuba Pro 20 series regulator is the wiper ring on the piston and the way it's set up allows you to leave this thing in the water for months at a time and it'll still work. Now, of course, the stage bottle, again, you can control it with a valve. If it doesn't work, it's nice not to have the stupid thing blow in your face when you turn it on. And these things we found will survive months in the caves as safety bottles and work perfectly. So this is kind of our workhorse stage bottle regulator. As far as the other tool that we use, the survey kit, which as you can see is blank at the moment, just use a forester's compass, little twist pencils, depth, azimuth, distance, underwater notepaper, and the famous decompression tables. Generally don't get used too often. Most of the diving, obviously, that we do, other than the ocean in the summertime, is with a dry suit. We use a shell suit simply because you don't want the buoyancy of the suit to be different at different depths. A neoprene suit has different buoyancy if you're higher up, and before it compresses, it's got a lot of buoyancy. You get deep, it compresses, it's got no buoyancy. It turns to paper like this. So it's ridiculous to use a neoprene dry suit. They're a little faster because they're smoother, but if you get a custom fit shell suit, you're going to get basically the same effect. The advantages of this far outweigh the little tiny bit extra speed you might be able to get with some other fabric. The thing that makes these unique, these DUI suits, is that the tri-laminate material, the thin material, the fact that the torso, the upper part of this thing, telescopes. And the fact that you can put it on by yourself is a self-donning with a zipper in the front. I keep my van key on that. Anyway, I like the automatic valve on the shoulder. You can be on either shoulder. It's probably easier to be on the right shoulder if you're going to scooter dive. I just leave mine on automatic and I just shrug my shoulder and advance. The piston valve has to be right in the middle. The pockets have to be on the side, nothing can be in the front. I use a tight pocket for all my emergency gears in the bottom here. I've got emergency seal things to slide over the seals if I break the seals. I've got towing straps. I've got plugs for my P-port. I've got other little things like that. On this side, I've got my big pocket where I have loops in here and rings where I just clip all my gear off. you know, my mask, my my double enders, my tow lines, my an extra backup light, all the stuff is in this pocket to the side. The P valve on these things, Barry Miller makes that. This one is one that I made. Barry makes it another one, but it has the same essential parts. It's got the VC valve fitting through the material. I've got check valves everywhere. These are all little check valves. They're a tenth of a PSI cracking pressure. I've got one here in case I break anything. This is all surgical tubing. This is a balance chamber check valve going that way that keeps this inflated from the suit so that this doesn't get crushed. This is another check valve here, which also acts like a thread. I like to leave, you know, have it nice, flexible tubing, and I put it inside the insulation, back down again. But this thing's a really nice feature. Barry makes one that comes ready to just goes right, you just punch the hole in the suit and it and the two sides screw together. It's pretty clever, much easier to deal with than this. This is much more labor intensive to make one of these. The on the outside, it has to be covered up so it doesn't catch on stuff. I have the material all the way down over it so it doesn't catch on boat ladders and things like that because I dive both ocean and cave. And it's a good idea to smooth it down like that and knock it off. It doesn't have to have the external thing, but I like to have a second shot so that it doesn't, you know, tend to break off. You don't want to put something through there connecting the two together because if you do catch it on something, it'll rip the dry suit instead of just breaking. Mine's breakaway, so if I do catch it, the outside will break away. There's a huge piece of material laminated over top of the thing on the inside, so it's not a problem. So it's just like, there's just little things like that that I have to think about because the amount of time that I spend underwater each time I dive requires that nothing can possibly go wrong. You also have a plug to plug that thing. Down here, we have a tight fit, but if you really want to get it so you can swim, the problem with if you have to do some swimming is if you don't want the, you know, like the feet moving in the suit. You can get so you can compress the suit down, but what I do is use these Halcyon gaiters, which just wrap around the leg, and capture the lower part of the dry suit, so that it's easier to get a good good kick and swim with the dry suit on. Buoyancy, you just push the air back into the feet when you want more feet high buoyancy. We generally use C4th insulate for everything, no matter what. We never change the insulation according to the dive. It's a bad idea to practice with one set of gear and then dive with the other. As far as mystery equipment, you know what that is. Mystery equipment. The scooters, we use these tow cords, which hook to the crotch strap and hold the scooter out in front like that. This tends to break the water. And on a scooter like this, it allows you to have several bottles because it's breaking the water already without slowing you down. If you were on top of the scooter, every time you add a piece of equipment, it's going to add more drag. Whereas if the scooter's in front of you, you can, you know, stagger the equipment back and stay within the slipstream. Let's look at a picture of a submarine running on the surface. Sometime you'll see what the water pattern, flow pattern looks like coming off of something like this. What's critical with these things is you know, things like length to width ratio. This is critical in the placement of your dive gear as well, and the position of stuff on the body.
Deep in a love that lasts forever, all I've ever wanted. Bring you closer. I want you by my side.